Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Are we all glad to be in the house of the Lord?
Yes.
Are we ready to receive His word?
Yes.
Hallelujah. It is a truly a wonderful privilege that every time we can gather here, the Lord will send His word to speak to our hearts concerning that which we need to hear. And believe me, we need to hear the word of God in these days. Amen?
Amen.
We need to be reminded of His love. Amen?
Amen.
Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. So tonight, I'm in the book of Psalms. Psalms 115. Psalms 115. It is a familiar prayer of David. And I will not read the whole psalm, though I'm tempted to. I will just read the verses that I need to focus on tonight for the message. And I'll be reading from verses 9 to 16. Psalm 115, verse 9 to 16. In the King James, it begins with, I'm still trying to find it. I hope I'm in Psalms. The psalm where David cries out unto the Lord, as we would be tempted to cry out unto God in our circumstances. Verse 1 says, "Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name, unto the name of Jesus," as we sang, "let it be, give glory." But I want to pick it up from verse 9. O Israel, I'm reading from the King James Version, trust thou in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, which is the priesthood of the Israelites, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. Verse 11, you that fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. The Lord hath been mindful of us. And I would put it this way. The Lord is mindful of us. The Lord our God is mindful of us.
Amen.
He will bless us. Is that in your Bible? The Lord our God is mindful of us. He will bless us.
Yes, sir.
Is that in your Bible?
Yes.
Good. He will bless the house of Israel. That means He will bless the priesthood of Israel and those who minister to God's people. He will bless the house of Aaron. Oh, that I mean first. He will bless them that fear Him, both small and great. Are you
Amen.
Seeing that in your word?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Are you ready to start jumping and shouting now? The Lord shall increase you more and more. You and your children.
Amen.
You see that in the word of God?
Yes.
You are blessed of the Lord which made heaven and earth. Do you feel blessed tonight?
Yes.
Some people are not saying amen. Phone say amen. Verse 16. The heavens, even the heavens, are the Lord's, but the earth had He given to the sons of men. Hallelujah. Tonight, we had a wonderful song service. We sang some songs as we usually, we worship God in some songs. that having heard or having just read those verses from Psalm, our spirits ought to be buoyed. Our hearts, though we'll faint, ought to be rekindled. And we should be standing up proud to go home early, because you don't need me to explain anything. Come on. If after those songs that we sang, if after the way we worship the Lord, he sent me to open the scripture in Psalm 115 that tells you, O Israel, trust in the Lord. He is your help and your shield. O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. He is your help and your shield. You that fear the Lord, you will say, well, I'm not Israel. I'm not Aaron. Well, God wants to make sure you're not left out. He said, you who fear the Lord, trust in him. He is your help and your shield. He said, the Lord has been mindful of us. What does that mean? You're on the mind, on the Lord's mind. The Lord sent this word. It's in the psalm. It's not words that the preacher is making up to make you feel good. It is the word of the Lord by appointment that is being read to us this day in the sanctuary. And we should say, like the children of Israel, praise be to God. The psalm said he will bless you, you and your children. I know we read it, you know. And we're ready for the message, so we don't want to read it again. We know that, right? Tell me what the Lord said. This is what he said. He's going to bless you, you and your children. Yeah. And I will put in my grandchildren there, right?
Amen.
You, I have one set of grandchildren. I need the Lord blessing them, I'm happy. You understand? He will bless you. I don't know how. Let us take God at his word. He didn't say he will bless you if you feel so. He said he will bless you. Now if the Lord says that I will bless you, the response of a grateful heart will be say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I needed to hear that. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It's not to sit down there and say, well, you know, Brother Glenn, I hear that already. I read it this morning. It's the word of the Lord. We minister nothing else. We believe nothing else, and we live by nothing else in this assembly. Somebody say amen. All right. But these verses of scripture, the Lord wanted me to read this into our spirits tonight. Because he has sent me with a message, and the message is entitled, God's Entitlement Plan. God's entitlement plan. You may want to consider it. The believer's entitlement. What you are entitled to. And of course, you can immediately see the connection. You are entitled to what is written here in Psalm 115. Kenneth, you alone saw that. You are entitled to be blessed of the Lord, you and your children. That's to begin with. Entitlement is a wonderful thing. Would you agree?
Yes.
Entitlement. That word called entitlement is a wonderful thing. Entitlement is to give or to confer on someone a title. Like it might be, whatever it is, you confer it on them. A benefit or a right, or to have something. Sorry. Or a benefit or a right to, or to have something. So when I have conferred on you that benefit, you will have it or you are going to have it. And that's an entitlement. Entitlement allows or qualifies you to particular benefits or favors. We know that. You apply for an NHA house. What entitles you to get the house? What entitles you to get a house? Okay, what have you done? Apply. So your application entitles you, not so? Not so? Come on, I'm not tricking. Okay. If you did not get a house, an NHA house, can you go to the minister and say, I did not get an NHA house? The first question is, were you entitled to one? And what should be your response? Well, I don't know. I hear they just give out house. But you apply. So your application is your entitlement. It seems simpler. Imagine I just had to apply and I get a whole big house. You see, entitlement is an act of grace, of kindness, or of benevolence as a result of meeting certain conditions. The example I used before, you apply. So you met the condition. We will give you. You don't have to build it. You don't have to paint it. We will give you. But your condition is sending the application. You know, something so simple that sometimes we fall behind. So it is an act of grace, kindness, or benevolence as a result of meeting certain conditions. And it is intended to make the beneficiaries better off than they would otherwise have been without it. In other words, when you get an entitlement, you are going to be better off than if you didn't get the entitlement. Amen? That's what it is. So we like entitlements. We like them. Those who are old enough, get your pension from NIS. And it was increased in the last administration. And you get your pension, whatever it is. That's your entitlement, that's all. If you go down to the post office, or probably your check didn't come, what would happen to you? You will make an inquiry because you did not receive your entitlement. You become entitled to it. Now, there's something about entitlement that we should know and understand. This is a side, but it's very important. You know, anything that we keep getting, that we do, something we don't deserve, we feel we're entitled to it. Yes, you know, that's another kind of entitlement, you know. Somebody keep getting somebody, and you know, that's why they say, you can't, you could, yeah, let me leave that alone. Okay. Entitlements come through some form of association. That's how you get it. How do you get entitlement? Through some form of association, be it family, kindred, members of the church. We have the place in Mayaro, and members are entitled to go there and relax. You know about that? If you're not a member, you're not entitled, not so? And if you want to go, you may find that there might be some charges that you'll have to first meet before you can be allowed, if that is yet a condition. I don't want to speak what I don't know. But we get something. We benefit from something. Only how? By association. Whether it's a formal or informal association. That is what entitlement is. But this is the point I want to make tonight through the Word of God. That entitlements become so binding that their rights are enforced in law. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, let me explain you. If you working in a company and they decide to give a bonus to everybody and you did not get it, wouldn't you claim discrimination and want to enforce it? Not so? Because the reason for the bonus is to all employees. And I think you're an employee. And you would take steps to try to enforce your rights. I'm going somewhere with this. Because what we are entitled to in Jesus, we need now to enforce it. And this is what God is saying. Amen. What we are entitled to, if you didn't get it, then you have to show up. By what you call the claims office? Show up by God's claims office on your knee in prayer. You understand? Because you are entitled to it. So once we get a hold of entitlement, once we understand how we behave when we do not get our entitlement, this is the message God wants to convey to us tonight. Often, however, and this is very important with an entitlement, the true worth of it, the fullness of it, is never really known or realized until you try to cash it in. Meaning that, take another example, an insurance policy or some sort of a mutual plan. All you know is you have the plan. All you know is that you contribute to the plan and that the plan is supposed to give you certain benefits. But the benefits do not accrue until the plan mature, in your case, until a particular age. So you probably may have gotten a receipt or a statement stating that you have X amount or Y amount. But when you went to cash it in, they say, no, you have a little more. Because what happened, some dividends were declared as a result. And you are entitled to it. In other words, once you have an entitlement, sometimes you don't really know the full extent of it. And that's the point I wish to make. The benefits are not limited only to what you may be aware of, if you have an entitlement, but it is limited, or it is as extensive as the act or the instrument conveying the entitlement. What I'm saying is that you may have a policy and you do not know all that it will cover. You probably have to get an attorney or get someone who are practiced in these matters to explain to you the fullness of it. No, you have the entitlement, but you do not know its fullness. It is therefore possible, for various reasons, to have an entitlement to certain benefits and privileges and not know it. As a result, in such a case, we remain without that which we rightfully deserve and that which is rightfully ours. That's the point I want to come to tonight. How wonderful this is. I did say entitlement is a wonderful thing. Now we as children of God, we are filled with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Ephesians 1:3. Yes. As children of God, we are filled, the word of God tells us so, with all spiritual blessings. We are filled with the goodness of God, Galatians 5:22-23, as children of God. We are filled with the goodness of God. But how did we become children of God? We became children of God because we believe in the name of Jesus. Amen. John 1:12. But to as many as receive him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even to them who believe on his name. Amen. So we became children of God because we believe. Somebody say amen. It is important that we get hold of it. We became children of God, transferred from darkness to light because of our belief. We did nothing other than believe in the name of Jesus. And that's a whole message in itself. Because there are many who say they believe in Jesus and have no evidence of being translated out of the kingdom of darkness. Amen. When you say you believe in Jesus, what do you mean? We believe in the name of Jesus. What do you mean? What is a person's name? A person's name is a word or expression that represents the person to us. And when we hear the person's name, it brings all of the person to us, not so? And all that we know about him. So when you hear the name of Jesus, and you say you believe in the name of Jesus, you believe in all Jesus was, all Jesus is, and what he lives to do as your mediator and savior. Not so? That is what Jesus is. You can't tell me that, yes, I believe in Jesus, but it's not this he will do. He is your healer if you believe in Jesus, not so? Because that's what Jesus is. The name of the person represents what the person is. Brother Glenroy, how you know Jesus is a healer? I read my Bible. The Bible said so. There was no manner of disease or sickness that he couldn't heal. Somebody say amen. So that's the name of Jesus. That is what it is to believe in Jesus. When you believe in Jesus, he is your counselor. When you believe in Jesus, he is your hope. When you believe in Jesus, he is your deliverer. When you believe in Jesus, he is our friend, our Lord, our Savior. That's who he is. We believe in that. Do you really believe? Do you really believe? I know we have quoted John 3:16 often. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. So we believe in Jesus for eternal life. And maybe the message escapes us. But I want to say that that verse should be, whosoever believeth in him, and Lord, I'm not adding, shall have even everlasting life. Because it's unto everlasting life. Why I'm making that is many people believe, well, the word of God and Jesus is about heaven and about going to heaven when we die. In other words, Jesus have nothing to do with me down here, except to punish me for what I do wrong. No, people could have a skewed impression or a skewed notion of Jesus. They say they believe in Jesus. But yes, that's to go to heaven. But you see, down in my job, I have a boss. You know? Jesus and the new lady, there are people who will say that men will do whatever they want and nobody could stop them or change them. When you have that opinion, what you do, you don't pray. You don't intercede to God to change anything because you believe that nothing can be changed. Man will be man. He bad and he's bad. So you're praying to God to change the heart of the government. But the government will do what they want. That's what you believe. But if you believe in Jesus, you know that he is the ruler of all. If you believe in Jesus, you will know that he rules in the affairs of men because the word of God says so. If you believe in Jesus, we know that he desires that none perish. He has the good of all at heart. And so if we believe in him and he is righteous ruler of the earth, wouldn't we call on him? That is if you believe. But if we do not believe, what are we going to do? We're going to say, well, I will pray for things that I want. A mere praying about them politicians at all. You understand? Them politicians will follow whatever policy they want. So you think. And this is why the message is coming. God's entitlement plan. So that's how we became the sons of God. Because of our belief in God. Our belief in Jesus. And how wonderful it is. It is a wonderful thing. But here is where our understanding of entitlement in Christ Jesus kicks off. Because we have just said that we are now the sons of God. Somebody say amen. Yeah. The place is too quiet. Somebody say amen. Yeah. We are now the sons of God. Yes. So, what are we entitled to as sons of God? You understand what God is trying to say to us tonight? You're entitled to. No, not you might have. No. You are entitled to. It is yours. You're supposed to get it. Isn't that what an entitlement is? Okay. Let us look at what the lot of the people of God is. Because we are not only the sons of God, but we are the people of God. We are told in the word of God that we are a peculiar people. We ought to be peculiar indeed. Possessors of the power of God, with all the entitlement of Almighty God, and we walk around not knowing it. We got to be peculiar indeed. Lord wants to clear that up to us tonight. No, there is no other qualification. There's none other than believing in the name of Jesus. I think I've said sometime before in a previous message, that many times we follow this plan or this habit of figuring that we must be able to merit something before we are entitled to it. And so the salvation of God comes free. The salvation of God comes graceful to us. And it is so much, Brother Glenroy, you telling me that I am entitled to that? Well, wait till we reach a little further down. What is the lot or expectation of the people of God? Now, you see, God didn't leave us guessing to think, well, listen, you're the people of God, so you're figuring out that God good, and as a result, because God good, well, you're figuring out you're entitled to this, and you only say, so. No. God told us that what is written aforetime is written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scripture will have hope. So in other words, if you want to know what is the lot of the people of God, let us go and look at the people of God in the Bible, not so?
Amen.
Amen. You could do that?
Yes.
Hallelujah. So to appreciate what the lot of a people of God is, if you are people of God, what is your lot? What is your entitlement then? What is your estate? That's what I mean. To appreciate that, we want to look at the children of Israel. Let me read this statement. God delivered them, he protected them, he provided for them, and he brought them into the promised land, those who believed. Amen. God delivered them from Egypt, from the bondage of Egypt, and we know that that is akin to God delivering us from the bondage of sin. God delivered them from the bondage of Egypt. He brought them through the wilderness. He protected them. The word of God said for 40 years, their foot didn't swell and their shoe didn't wear out. It's in the word of God. And although we have read about them being a rebellious people, whatever they want, he provided. Of course, they didn't like the manna. That's a whole different message. Right? They wanted chicken and chips. God gave them something that he knows is best for them. Remember, God knows what is best for us. I know we don't like that statement. You know, but he created everything and then he made man. So he knew what we want. So don't feel that whatever God is going to give you is something that is not good for you. But the children of Israel made that mistake. And so they lost it and they murmured and whatnot in the wilderness. But we saw that God delivered them. He provided for them. He protected them. And he brought them into Canaan just as he said he would in his covenant with Abraham. Amen. Amen. So say amen with boldness, because this is so. This affects us, and I'll show you how. So be confident about the word of God. Now I said those who believe. And we know also that of all that came out of Egypt, only two, Joshua and Caleb, are the only ones that entered into the promised land. Because all the others did not believe, and they died in the wilderness. Okay, what happened to them? Because they did not believe, they did not come into what they were entitled to. Come on. I think that is simple. We get it, we go home early. Huh? I don't want to preach again. Because you did not believe, you died in the wilderness, not coming into your desired haven, into the plan that I had for you, into the things of which you are entitled to. So we see, therefore, it's our faith and our belief that brings us to get the things from God. So anytime we want to say that we did not receive from God, don't let us not foolishly charge God. Let us not doubt or go back. Let us look at our belief, because that is the example. I am asking us, what is the lot of the people of God? Who God provided, who God protected, who God took out of bondage, he brought them into freedom, and who God gave the promised land, who believed? I ask that question. And this is to parallel us, who have a greater entitlement than the children of Israel had, and of the story that we read in the Word of God. Now look at the other thing that God did for the people of God. He gave them the land, that's the land of Canaan. He drove out the inhabitants from the land, but not all. He left some for them to drive out. You understand that? He gave them the land. It's their land. They entitled to it. That's their entitlement. What did God do? He drive out the inhabitants, but he didn't drive out all. He left some, and he told them, no, you drive them out, lest they remain a snare unto you. So that, how does this parallel us? God has delivered us. He has set up a great victory for us in Christ Jesus. And now he has told us to go in and possess your inheritance.
Amen.
Come on, I get two amen. Amen. He has told us to go in and take now what I've given you. Come on. I don't think this word deep at all. In other words, God set them up for victory or success.
Amen.
He didn't kill everybody. He didn't. You see what he leave? He know you could kill them. Go ahead now. As a matter of fact, he told Joshua. He say, every foot of ground that you tread on, I give it to you. But just be courageous.
Amen.
So what Joshua tread on, he got. What Joshua didn't tread on, he didn't get. And this is my next point. The children of Israel were entitled to the land, for God gave it by covenant, for God by covenant had given it to them. What they did, or what they conquered, they had, and what they didn't do, they didn't have. This is where the Lord wants to minister to us tonight. Children of God, children of faith, his beloved. It is us, it is you. It is you Jesus died for. Come on. Don't listen. Forget every other Christian in the world. You are allowed right now by this preacher only to be a little selfish. Jesus died for you. I'm speaking to you personally. I know he died for the whole world, and I say, pastor say, you know, but I want you to personalize the thing. You know, let me leave that here. I want you to personalize it. I'll tell you why. Because by the Spirit of God, God wants us to know what we are entitled to. When Jesus went to the cross, Jesus didn't go to the cross for himself. When in the agony in Calvary, in Gethsemane, he cried out, he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible with you. Let this cup pass. Nevertheless, your will, the will of the Father, Leroy, will be saved and free and delivered from the crutches of sin that held him. Deliver from evil and hate. Deliver from adultery and wickedness that will wreck his life. I went to the cross. If he pays so great a price for me, don't you think that I want all that I am entitled to?
Yes.
And shouldn't you and I be saying the same thing? This is why we are talking about God's entitlement plan tonight. So we looked at what the lot is, or the estate is, of the children of God. So we are the children of God by faith, and that is how we understand God dealt with the children of God. And if you, to give more clarity to the message, consider how individual children of God were dealt with. Consider Joshua, consider David, consider Samson, consider those who trusted in God, as the scripture read. Oh, you fear the Lord, trust in him. So the example is there. It is full in the scripture that we know how God deals with his own. Amen?
Amen.
They are entitled to his protection. They're entitled to his provision. They're entitled to his blessing. They're entitled to his salvation. But we want to look at the term sons of God. To them he gave power to become the sons of God. Now, this is where the thing gets a little nice, a little different. It's the same thing, eh? But when you tell me I'm your son, come on, man. Then you're my father, not so?
Yeah.
Then what is yours is mine. Somebody say amen.
Yeah.
Somebody say amen.
Yeah.
What is God's is yours. That is where God wants us to be. You see, for you and I, it is difficult. And we would spend a lifetime to try to grasp it. And we may never grasp it in our lifetime. Just as how scientists is right now discovering that there are more and billions of galaxies in the universe. They're now discovering that. Galaxies that they thought didn't exist, they're seeing them. It's as though God up there creating more. Just so, what the word of God meant, eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, Neither had it entered into the heart of man. The things that God has prepared for those who love him.
Amen.
Come on, that's a better amen. Amen. Don't tell me that you ain't going to run and jump. Don't tell me that you're not happy at that. This is what God has in store for you because you love him.
Amen.
Because you love him.
Amen.
Because you love him.
Amen.
Please, we need to get this into our spirit so that it will affect our prayer. It will affect our coming to God. It will affect our walk with God. We need to get it so that it will affect our relationship with God. Don't look at it as a maybe. I know. Listen, many times I don't feel worthy. Listen, you think I feel worthy? Many times I don't feel worthy. Lord, you mean me? And then the Holy Spirit says, yes, you. And then when I'm doubting, he takes me through the word. And I spend time in my Bible and I keep saying, my Lord, well, if this is so, if this page is here, well, then I believe this, you know. Many times I say, Lord, if I tear this page out, what is left? And then I go down somewhere and I see it in another form. This is how I have my battles with the Lord. Because I have to believe that this thing is for me.
Amen.
So let us look at the entitlements of the Son of God. Now to know this, we have only one Son of God, the only begotten Son of the Father, that was revealed to us, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Not so?
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Right. He is the pattern son. Jesus is the pattern son. In other words, he is the one we take in our example from. Oh, gosh. Come on. He was revealed for our example. He was the only Son of God, and the Word of God says that we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. Oh, wonderful Savior. So he is our pattern. Let's apply. I ministered here on the day that Jesus, on the story when Jesus was in the boat asleep. And the disciples wake him up and say, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And Jesus got up and he said, where's your faith? And I asked the question, and of course, after he said that, he rebuked the winds and the wave, and the storm became a calm. And I asked the question, did Jesus expect Peter to stand up on the boat and tell the wave, shut up, as he did? What would you say? It's rhetorical. It's not a trick question. But ask yourself that. Because before he rebuked the wind and the wave, he said, where is your faith? Well, faith to do what? Watch the waves and not say anything? Faith to leave me sleep and just ride out all the roughness? Is that what God wanted? Ask yourself the question. And Jesus, even at another time, when he healed the epileptic boy, the father brought the boy to the disciples and they couldn't heal him. And then he brought it to Jesus. And Jesus said, oh, faithless generation, how long will I suffer you? In other words, get the devil out of the boy. Come on. Okay, what did Jesus mean then? Tell me. Jesus, get the devil out of the boy. Of course, when he went into the house, of course, first, Jesus healed the boy. He cast the spirit of epilepsy out. When the disciples went into the house, hear what the disciples say. So, Master, why couldn't we get him out? You remember that story? In Mark chapter 9. Jesus said, because of your unbelief. What did Jesus say? Because of your unbelief. I have to come to a close now. The issues we have before God, the things that are standing against us or troubling our minds, what do we think about them? Do we think that they are insurmountable? Do we think that we are entitled to have them move, to have them overcome, to overcome them, or to be given the strength to go through? What do you think? Do we think that we are going to buckle under the pressure that Satan is throwing at us? 2 years ago, I lost 50% of my business. That was a lot of money. A lot of money. As a matter of fact, we are at the end of July, and it is about exactly 2 years to the date. I became so negative, so fearful, all kinds of scenario of what you have built up for over 30 years in business came crashing almost. I'm 2 years after, and I have not hit the ground. And I will not hit the ground.
Amen.
But what happened? Why I told you that? The thing, when you look at the thing, when you start to analyze it in your mind, it seems as though this thing is never going to get better. You understand why the Lord sent the scripture? You who fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is your help and your shield. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Come on, somebody say amen.
Amen.
If you fear the Lord, if you reverence the Lord, trust in him, for he is faithful.
Amen.
I could remember there are some in our lives. We were sick probably years ago. Something had happened to us. People pray for us. We didn't know what was happening. All kind of thing happened to we. We get all... leave that alone. And it looked as though we will not recover, didn't it? Look at us today. Look at us today. Look at us today. What happened? When the first set of believers came into your room and they prayed for you, you didn't jump up out of the bed and walk out, so you believe God didn't do you anything. Look at you today. Look at you today. I have prayed for many people. And having left the prayer room, they did not recover. I see them today. I could remember praying for a young woman who was being treated in the infirmary for cancer. All kinds of things coming out on this young woman's body. I lay in my hands and I say, Lord, give me the faith. I believe your word. That was some 5-6 years ago. Did you see a young lady there? If you see buxom, let me leave that alone. What I'm saying is that what happened to us is that we expect something to happen a particular way, and we doubt the word of God. But David said it like this, and I love what David said. He said, I have been young, now I am old. I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. You will not beg bread. You are blessed of the Lord. You will be blessed by your household will be blessed. Your family will be blessed. Your name is blessed. Your situation is blessed. And that is what God wants us to know. Because we are entitled. I don't have time. I'm out of time. I can't go into the entitlement of sons. This is such a wonderful word that the Lord gave me on the second anniversary of my major mishap. I got negative with my wife, thank God. Look at sitting up there. She had to tell me something. I taught you believe in God. When I get rebuked, I say, yes, I believe. Because I believe God. You see, the funny thing is, we believe God, and I know you are like me. You really believe God. You are not in here because you don't believe God. But Satan has a way, this wave, he was throwing the wave like that. And he tell you, no, you're dying. No, God. And you want to run by pastor. Pastor, you see that wave? I did know. And pastors tell you, no, Jesus calmed the waves, remember? Trust him. Well, how my wave will come? And I ministered that the last time. There's something called causality. Cause and effect. Jesus knows. God knows. Remember, he didn't take away all the enemies. So he knows, you see them little ones that go nibble at the heel, you either get straight, throw them out, or they will overcome you. Now, the things that are bugging us, the things that are hampering us, what are we going to do? Not use our entitlement as the sons of God? But it's hard for me to close this message without just reading what I have. I'm not going to develop on it because I want to read this into your spirits. I talk about the pattern, son. I say we need to look at Jesus as the example. And I said that Paul considered this, and in Romans 8:32, he answered that God must give us freely all things with Christ. So the very first thing you and I have as believers is all things
Amen.
With Christ Jesus.
Amen.
If you read it, Paul said, he who spared not his own son, but
offered him up for us. Well, how? Paul couldn't understand. Paul said, a son of a Trinidadian, he's a Jew. How could he not demand give Jesus for us? And where you hold back from you? So just notice that he will freely give us all things. The next point I want to make is that, again, in Galatians, Paul said, he was forced to conclude, as anyone who dares to consider our entitlement as believers, that we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. For because we believe, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son, Jesus, into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. When we cry to Jesus, to God, we cry, Abba, Father. That is significant. That is a whole message. I can preach Abba, Father for the next hour. And we will still be understanding Abba, Father. Why? Remember I said entitlements come through relationship. So we are entitled to a relationship. We are entitled to benefits and privileges as sons of God. And I need not enumerate them here. Healing, peace, forgiveness, righteousness, blessings, prosperity. Yes, we're entitled to. But remember, if we do not claim our entitlement, because there's always a devil or somebody interfering in your garden, not so? Yes. And that will be the topic for the next message. Can you stand to your feet? Tonight, as the choir sings, don't wait for the choir to finish singing. You have a need tonight. Remember, you are entitled to your Father supplying your need. And we do that by praying for you and interceding for you at the altar. Tonight, whatever your need is, be it emotional, be it economic, be it physical healing, be it spiritual growth and development, come to the altar as the choir sings and let us lift up our need to God, because you are entitled to the blessings of God in your life. Amen?
Let's congregation may be seated if you wish. You may be seated if you wish.
Christ forever I stand. the joy.